Do you know how a mixture behaves during evaporation?
Hi everybody, this is Pablo again. Maybe you have some difficulties to understand the liquid mixture, but don't be scared, I'll try to explain you.
Hi Pablo, yes, on our last video I understood how the pure components behave. However, I guess that's gonna become more difficult when we deal with mixtures. Gasoline, for instance. How does gasoline behave?
Well, here is where it gets interesting. Unlike water, which is a pure component, gasoline is a mixture of different components, such as alkanes, alkenes, isoalkanes, aromatics, and other additives. In a mixture of different components, boiling occurs over a range of temperatures, rather than at fixed temperature.
What? A range of temperatures? Do you mean that gasoline begins to boil at one temperature and ends at another one?
You see this graph? Well, it's a bit simplified, since we here consider a mixture of only two components, but the idea is the same when there are many. It shows the phase behavior of N-butene and N-octane at atmospheric pressure. On the left, you see 125.6 degrees Celsius. This is the boiling temperature of octane. On the right, you see minus 0.5 degrees Celsius. This is the boiling temperature of butane. In between, you'll find the behavior of the mixture.
I don't understand it. I see here two lines that link the points you've just mentioned, but what do they mean?
Well, in fact, when you evaporate a mixture, the composition of the liquid and vapor is different. This can be easily understood. The heavier component, here octane, with a higher boiling point, will remain longer in the liquid phase than the lighter component.
Yes, octane remains in the liquid while butane goes into the vapor.
Well, that's a common mistake. In fact, if we observe our diagram, let's say 60 degrees Celsius, we can observe that the liquid composition is close to 18% of butane, whereas the vapor composition is about 90% of butane.
In other words, we can see better this behavior on the diagram.
What? Are you telling me that at 60 degrees, where all butane is supposed to be vapor, you can still find a part of it into the liquid phase? But that's really weird.
Well, but that's reality. In fact, you can separate completely two components of a mixture. You can say that octane is a good solvent that dissolves part of the butane. And the opposite is true as well. Some octane will be vaporized at 60 degrees Celsius, even though its boiling point is 125.6 degrees Celsius.
So, if I add more octane, I will condense more butane, right?
Yes, as we can see, by adding octane, we can condensate a part of the vapors of butane at 60 degrees Celsius, finding another way to condensate a vapor, other than reducing its temperature.
Yes, I get it. So if I read the curve from the bottom up, I can see that the boiling point of my 50-50 mixture is 20 degrees Celsius and that it keeps evaporating until 105 degrees Celsius. That's a very wide range.
Yes, you got it. In fact, the lowest temperature is called the bubble temperature, where the first bubble appears in the mixture. The highest temperature is called the dew temperature, because at that point, the mixture becomes entirely vapor.
Okay, until now, we have seen that a mixture can be composed for many components, the same who will have different behavior depending on its mixture composition. But I was told that it is possible to separate two compounds using evaporation. This is called distillation, as for example in refineries, where the heavy and light fractions are separated. But tell me, do you know how does it work?
You're right. Distillation uses this principle. A liquid is partly evaporated. Let's continue with our example.
But as you said, the vapor is not pure, right? It contains both butane and octane.
You're right again. Yet, it contains more butane than octane. The vapor is condensed, and a second distillation stage is needed. And perhaps a third, in order to improve the separation.
Aha, so this is why a distillation column is used. On each stage, we have a liquid-vapor equilibrium.
That's it. And as you see, there's also a lot of energy involved. At each stage, you need to evaporate and condense. This is why separation is very energy intensive.
I really hope you have enjoyed this topic. Maybe, in another occasion, I could explain you what would happen if we mix hydrocarbons with components like water.